Right, so today we're going to be looking at surfaces. And surfaces are effectively just a way of creating a topography that describes something about your data. So the three ones that we're really going to be looking at today are so like tins, faecens, and density surfaces. Faecens are sort of a surface, but you'll see what I mean in a little bit. Right. So first of all, we're going to look at vector surfaces. Obviously, all surfaces are going to break down into either vectors or raster surfaces. Now, a lot of these, in either cases, including the raster surfaces, they don't need to be derived from a raster. They can be derived from vector data. And it's particularly true with tins, otherwise known as triangulated irregular networks. So this is an example of a big-ass tin. And it's, as you notice, it's quite literally just made up of triangles. Now this is the same sort of technology-ish that they will use in computer games when if you switch it to wireframe mode in a computer game, you'll notice everything is made up of triangles, a bit like this. And it's the same sort of concept, but I'll explain exactly the difference between that in seconds. Okay, so when we're starting off and talking about triangulated irregular networks, first of all, just a very brief, as a geometry there, I suppose. But just to understand like how we define different parts of the network. So each of the nodes within the network is simply known as a vertex, and then all of the lines linking each of these separate nodes is known as an edge. So it's quite literally corners and edges on there. And then the bit in the middle, that we were going to be referring to that as the face. And the idea of what we're going to do with a triangulated network, so it's, as opposed to finding ourselves with triangulation, with a triangulated network, we want to effectively create us like a... make sure that every single node in the network is linked up with an edge. And so it will just create a series of triangles in this network. And... Good morning, Nina. Grab a seat. No worries. That's nice. There we go. Freeze the crowd. I'll get you to sign this so I know who doesn't turn up. So just pop your name and number on there. And so we're just talking about sort of doing surfaces today. And the first one we're talking about is triangulated networks. So it's literally how you build a network of edges between like the different points. We call these points vertexes. But the aim of any triangulated network that we want to create is that if we draw a line from one point to another in this network, it's either going to be an adjacent point, so therefore we're just going to have a straight line to that point, there's going to be an edge between the two points, like in that case, or in the case of one that's further away, one that's not adjacent, if we go back here, so say if we're drawing a line between this point and this point, it is going to pass through at least one edge. So that's the aim of a triangulated network. That's how we know it's a true triangulated network. And there's a crazy complex piece of maths, that you can do to like prove this, to give this a mathematical proof. Okay. So in very basic triangulation, the idea is that we've got these points, well I'll show you on the board in a second, we've got all these points that we've just created, and these could be anything. These are, I know you were talking about sinkholes, so let's imagine this is your sinkholes, you want to create a, like, we want to make a network between them. And then, so the idea is we draw an arbitrary axis, so in this case we're going to say that the beginning of the axis is here, and it's going to go that way, and we choose like the one that's like furthest this way on the axis, and then go to the second one there, and we connect it with an edge. And then we choose the next one along, and we connect it with the previous, and then you enclose the triangle. And that's how you do it. And then you repeat the steps ad infinitum. So that's how you triangulate a network in its most basic format. I'll just give you a quick display, because I think it's... Once you've got this... So... Let's say we've got a whole bunch of points here. There's one there, 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 there. Okay. And then we're going to say our axis is pointing this way. And we will start at our one on the first end of the axis, which is this point here. We move to the next one along, which is this one. And we're going to connect it to the first point. And then once that's connected to the first point, we're going to move on to the next one along, which is this one here. And then we connect it to that one. And then we can we enclose that triangle? We can't enclose that triangle. So move on to the next one, which is this one here. Connect it there. And we can enclose that. And we can move on to the next one. Is that there? And then we can enclose that to there. This one. Enclose that. This one. Okay, so I'll tell you, I'll just move that out of the way so you can see that a little bit better. But as you can see, we've created a network here, but it's not complete. And this is one of the things that with a triangulated network is we want to create, put in what's called a concave shape. And a convex hole. So that the outer boundary of this network is going to be, is constantly like angling inwards. Now, there are reasons why you would want to make a convex hole, so they've got like this one. There are reasons that you'd want to have like bits where you've effectively got an inlet or something like that. But we're not interested in that for this case. So what you need to do is just fill up the gap. So once you've completed that, you quite literally just fill up the gap. So we'll do one there. In this case, that one goes there, and like that. And there you go. That's a completed network there. But that's a very basic way of doing it, and unfortunately, it's not particularly optimised either. So the reason it's not optimised is because in this network, so for example, this one, I don't think this one's optimised, but see, in these two triangles here, they're quite long and extended. There are obtuse triangles, I believe. Well, basically, they're long and skinny. We don't want that. We want as many equal, well, the triangles in our network to be as equilateral as possible. And the reason we want it to be equilateral as possible is because if you've got, so say this is a surface running on here, and we're actually doing like a height map. This one, you're getting a bit lower resolution here because it's stretched over a larger distance. So we need to like reduce that surface size to make it a little bit smaller. And to do that, we make it into equilateral triangles. And the way that you generally do this to make things more optimized, to get more equilateral triangles in a network, is to do this thing that they call the bistellar flip. So in a bistellar flip, we look at any two triangles which are adjacent to one another. And so for example, here's an example configuration here. So we've got two obtuse triangles. I think there's obtuse triangles, I could be wrong. There's triangles with long flat triangles. And what we're going to do is we're just going to switch the axis running from A to B to C to D. And what we're looking for is an increase in the size of the smallest angle in the network, in the configuration. So currently the smallest angle in this configuration, for any of the triangles, remember these two are going to be the same values. So it's going to be these triangles here. They're going to be the smallest value. But if we switch it 90 degrees, going from C to D, all of a sudden the smallest value of an angle is going to be there. And that tells us that the triangles that we've created have become more equilateral. And in doing so, we've optimized that position. So, does that make sense?
Yeah.
That's pretty straightforward. So what we could do, we could quite literally go through triangle by triangle of the network that we've done and find where you've got the adjacent triangles and just switch the axis and see what we have, turn by turn. So in computer science, when you get an algorithm to do that, you stop at the top left and you work down to the bottom right. And you'd look at each pair as you go along, you'd optimise it and move on to the next pair. But that's not the best way of doing it. I mean, it would still increase the optimization, but it's not necessarily the best way of doing it. And to work out the best way of doing it, we need to travel back in time to a chap called Fales. So Fales is, I suppose he's like the father of modern day geometry. He was an ancient Greek mathematician. And he focused a lot on geometry. And anyway, he realized this rule that any set of 3 points that you put down on a piece of paper or whatever, you can always form a circle from these 3 points. You can use those as effectively like parts of the outer bits of the circle. And thus that means, so it's effectively any 3 points that you ever put on a flat plane can be drawn as a circle, and they create a unique circle. And the way we can prove it from the other way around is that you can just draw any circle, put 3 points in it, wherever you want, and it's always going to make a triangle out of that. So, but the way we work out where the circle is by working out what's called the circumcenter of the triangle. So in each of these cases, the circumcenter is effectively, if we take the midpoint from each edge, and then you put like a perpendicular line from that edge, it's going to be the points where these three lines are going to intersect. So, for example, in this case, they intersect right in the inside of the triangle here, and that's a fairly equilateral one. Or in this case, the circumcenter is actually outside of the triangle. But once you've found the circumcenter, the distance between the circumcenter and each of the points on the circle are going to be equidistant. So if you get your compass out and you start drawing a circle from that point, it's going to cover each of these. And it's going to be the same with that. If you get your compass out and put your bit there, each of these points are going to be the exact same different distance from the circumcenter. And this creates what we call the circumcircle. It's a bit of a mouthful, but there you go. So that's how we know. And a chap, I forget his first name, Delaney, he realized that the best way to optimize a network was to use this concept of drawing circles around triangles. And so his idea was, breakthrough was by realizing if a configuration of triangles, so adjacent triangles, is unoptimized, if you draw a circumcircle around one of the triangles, is going to enclose the fourth point. And in doing so, we know that that one's unoptimized. But in this case, all we need to do is just flip it. So this is like the same one we had earlier. We flip the axis, and now we draw the circumcircles around the triangles, and lo and behold, they do not enclose the other points. The circles overlap, that's fine, but they do not enclose that fourth point. And in doing so, we now know that that is optimized. So the idea of what we call Delaney triangulation is this: the algorithm is going to run in your network and it's going to draw a bunch of circles around effectively each of the triangles, and it will find the one where no circle encloses another point. So a fourth point on the network. There is no other way to produce a greater optimized network than using Delaney triangulation. So incidentally, ArcMap only uses this method of triangulating networks. I mean, some of them use others, but they're not as nearly as good. So this is the ultimate, pretty much the only way to do it. So here's an example of Delaney triangulation, and this is how the computer would visualize it when it's trying to work out which the best optimized ways of doing. Looks a bit crazy, but you can understand. It makes sense now. Everybody get that? Yeah? It's pretty straightforward. Okay, so if we move on. So far we've just been talking about flat planes. We know how to optimize our network using Delaney triangulation. But what can we do with these networks? So we've got these things called TINs, like triangulated irregular networks. And the idea of the TIN is that we're not, so far all of the ones we've done just have an X and a Y axis along a Cartesian coordinate system. But this one we're going to include a Z axis. And that Z axis could be anything from, population, it could be altitude, it's just something that's going to have a volume attached to it. And then all from that, we can triangulate the network, and then we can start adding Z axis variable. And this is going to give us a differential topography as we go along it. And then we can draw all kinds of wonky things out of this stuff. And it's going to sort of fill in the gaps of where it thinks. So what this effectively allows us to do is to work out the slope. So you can't necessarily do that with just raster data. You can't look at it and say, oh, this is the slope here. With this, we can now determine the slope and which way the slope of something is going. So let's say this is actually a map that's going to tell us population, right? I suppose. So imagine this is like a population map over like a whatever geographic area. So we say, oh, that's probably going to be a city there. But we're going to say, as we go this way, the population decreases sharply. So maybe there's a reason for that area being more built up than that area. And then you get sort of DEMs. So DEMs work in a similar way, or DEMs. They work in a similar way to this idea of like the wireframe model I was talking about in computer game systems. So you'll see, I'm sure you've used DEMs already, but there it's taken from a raster format. So effectively it's a raster picture that was taken in LiDAR or whatever. And then we've already assigned different values to each of the points in the grid. And then all the DEM does, it applies the linear triangulation on top of that. But because it's a grid, because it's an equal grid with equal squares in there, everything in there is going to be an equilateral triangle. So that means it's going to be like super, super optimized. So people like the USGS in the States or whoever, they use these models extensively to give us, to create DEM models out of it. They've got a very specific file type that they use. And the methods they use to collect the data, so they can get a raster, you create a grid out of that, and voila. You get something beautiful like that. So there you go, that's how it works. Right, so if we move on to raster surfaces. So the first one we're going to look at is, raster surfaces. Again, you don't necessarily need a complete raster data, but you can effectively create a raster out of it. So here's an example of a very complicated map that we want to work out what the hell's going on here. So this is a map of every single convenience store in Tokyo Bay. And as you can see, the Japanese love convenience stores for some reason. It's their thing. And if you look carefully, we can actually pick out some patterns in here. So there seems to be a much greater density of them as we're heading into town this way. And as you can see, there's more clustering in the center. But the thing is, we're just trying to pick it out from our naked eye from there. What we need is some way of working out where it's most dense and where it's most sparse. And quite literally, we use this thing called density analysis, we call density surfaces. So there's three ways that we generally do this. So we've got point density, line density, or kernel density. Now point density maps is you quite literally get your features and then you say, I'm going to draw a radius around each of my features. Let's say maybe 20 meters or something. And whenever these radiuses from the features overlap each other, it increases like the volume of that thing in the area. So let's say that's on volume one, there volume one there, and that becomes two. And then the more that overlap, the greater the density in these particular areas. That's...
Line density is the exact same thing, except we're just building it around lines instead of points. Fairly straightforward. And then in the third one, we've got kernel density. Now, kernel density creates an algorithm that effectively decides like an area of control. So every point on the surface is going to create like a little area of control. And if they start, if there's numerous ones in that area, if there's strong autocorrelation, it's going to build like a what we call like they describe it as like as a neighborhood. And this neighborhood creates a boundary around it. And then they will show like as you move away from these points and you move away from the neighborhoods, this density will like break, that will slowly break down to zero. So, oh yes, and then importantly, so the boundaries in these ones don't overlap. They just like aggregate together. Sorry, I'll show you what I mean. So, for example, so we don't need to put line density up here. Can everybody see that, right? But okay, so I can't remember what this is showing, but this is just a purely example. So these are the initial points here, and we want to find out the density of these points here. So this is what we'll create if you're just using a point density map, or a point density surface there. And as you can see, you can see like the vague outline there of these little points overlapping, but in here we've got a nice bit of clustering there which is showing us something is happening there. But in the kernel density, you can see what I mean when they're building like these neighborhoods around these points. And when the points get together, they create a higher value. The course, you get that distance decaying until it breaks down to nothing. Now, as to which one's better, I'd generally say, I'd imagine kernel density is more useful because it's extrapolating, it's interpolating some ideas and filling in the gaps. But point density, I guess, is it's more precise. So if you want. So let's say we wanted to create a map showing us. So somebody's gone for a field and they worked out where every single mine left over from recent conflict is. And then we can put all the mines in there and we can create like the blast radiuses of each of these mines. So we can say, okay, that's the blast radius there. But we know if you screw up there and there's a big chain reaction, you'll be turned into like human chum, I guess. Whereas if we wanted to create a generalized risk map for the same field, it might be better to do a kernel density, so we know which areas just to be wary where to step. Okay, so here's the point density map of London, and this one is the point density of all of the crimes in London, I think, in 2015. And I'm pretty sure, from the looks of it, I could be wrong, but that looks like a point density map to me. So, as you can see, right, so I wouldn't like to be there, so yeah, there you go. Just South London-ish. Westminster, there you go. City's capital, very high levels of crime. Don't know why. But if we look where we are, so we are Kingston down here. It's actually quite nice down here. Not too much crime at all, so there you go. You're lucky to be here. There you go, that's an idea. Okay, now here's a wonderful example showing us, so this is kernel density. And this is going to show us this is the power of density maps. So, both of these images are from recorded earthquakes in an area in, I think it's southern Colorado. So all of these dots here, these are earthquakes. These little triangles here are fracking sites. These are coal bed methane fracking sites. And this is every single earthquake they've ever had from 1888 to 1987. And this was before fracking took place in the area. So as you can see, there's two hotspots here, generally, which probably coincide roughly with the coal beds, and because coal beds are generally a little bit more friable than other rocks, so they may be a bit more unstable. As you can see, but there's no, apart from these two hotspots, there's no real distinctive super strong water correlation. However, these are all the earthquakes between 1988 and 2005. And I believe fracking starts to take place in this area in the it's in the mid-2000s, so it's about 2003 that they start, or no, late 90s they start fracking in this area. And all of a sudden you've got this really, 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 really strong autocorrelation. So I'm not taking into account these ones here, just the earthquakes since this, we stopped taking data from these. But now there's a very, very strong autocorrelation of earthquakes happening definitively near the sites where we're fracking. So this is what's called coal bed methane fracking. So so coal, like oil, degrades over time, and as it degrades it creates gas. And it used to be that we used to burn off the gas, but then we realised that gas is really efficient, and that's when we started taking gas off. But some of the gas is actually caught inside like the structure of the rock itself, so you need to crack it open and create like low density pockets. That's how fracking works. Now, the only thing I'll say about this study, it doesn't tell us the intensities of these earthquakes. So for all I know, these could all quite be like Richter 3, which is, you know, like somebody sneezing. And here is the combined map of all of the earthquakes, right back to 1888, all the way up to 2005. So this is, includes every earthquake they've had before then, and every earthquake they've had since they've started fracking. And as you can see, that water correlation is still very strong. Gone has this second cluster of earthquakes has pretty much been subsumed by this large, very strong site kernel density of water correlation there, showing us that fracking in the area has definitely caused a change in the deposition of earthquakes. There is, you know, this is very clear and damning evidence. Now, whether that is, as I said, we don't know the intensity of these earthquakes, because the study unfortunately doesn't say it, but it does show that there is a very strong correlation with the fracking and the location of it. And just to prove it to you, here's the frequency over time of all of these earthquakes. So this is way back when they got their first one here, so that's 1878. And as you can see, it's pretty stable. There's a peak there, but with earthquakes you expect like a peak every now and then, just like it's like a rogue wave. It's a non-linear wave, just appears for maybe a time when you've got increased frequency, but and as you can see, it drops straight back down to the base amount after that. But here we go, 1988 is when they start fracking, sorry, so late 80s, early 90s. And at first it's pretty much fine, and then all of a sudden in 2003 everything goes crazy, and we've got this huge increase of earthquakes. And it's quite hard to speculate what's going on there. It could be that the fracking has caused instability in the actual beds itself. It could be that the fracking is allowing fault lines to relieve tension as it's effectively lubricating fault lines. We don't know. We can't, I can't tell. Without further study, we can't tell. But there is definitely a correlation with the action of it and the appearance of earthquakes afterwards. Okay. So far, when we've been looking at the densities, we kind of just create a boundary around them, and that boundary fades away into nothing. So we did very much like just quite local distance decay. Interpolation is this idea that we want to fill in the gaps. It's in maths we describe interpolation. Well, interpolation is effectively trying to work out the values of things between separate data points. So, for example, let's say this is rainfall, and this is a rainfall station in London, and then over here we've got a rainfall station in Birmingham. And at this point here, the rainfall is, I don't know, one. So we'll say that's 1 centimeter of rainfall there. But on the same day, over in Birmingham, it's got 2 centimeters of rainfall there. But what you want to try, the thing is, we don't have a weather station in between these two points. So we've got to try and fill in the gaps. And what we do is, we call this interpolation. The idea that we're going to create we're going to assume the values of what could be in the middle there. And there's a bunch of different ways that you can do this, but in its most simple form, we're going to assume that it just changes. You know, one set, we break the distance down into 10, you know, 10 separate chunks, and we're going to say in each of these separate chunks, the value of the rainfall is going to change. I hope that makes sense, interpolation. And it's, yes, and it's different from extrapolation. So, interpolation, we're going to try and determine the values between these two points, between these two data points here. If we're going to extrapolate a value, we're going to try and continue the data points outside of our data set. Right, so the most basic form of interpolation, so this, again, this is from maths itself, is we're going to, so let's say we, so for example here, this is like height versus weight. So we weigh everybody in the class, and we also measure everybody's height. So let's say that's height and that's weight. And these are the two separate data points there, and we've kind of drawn like a line of best fit. And we say, well, okay, if somebody's like 5 foot, whatever, we don't have somebody's 5 foot, whatever, we want to find out what weight they are. We just go along there and see where the line of best fit is, and then we can just interpolate that there. Makes sense? And so let's say, we're taking the readings from a bunch of, so this is, let's say, over distance. And again, this is going to be like rainfall. We've gone in from north to south, but this time we've got a few different weather stations in a straight line from here, let's say, all the way up to Newcastle. And as we're going up there, we're seeing that the rainfall amount changes. So we can actually just draw a straight line between these points, and that's going to give us predicted rainfall at any other position between these points. Does it make sense? It's pretty straightforward. Now, there are other ways of doing this. So, for example, there's spline interpolation. And the idea of a spline interpolation is that we're going to create a curve around our data points. And this is going to allow us to infer data that could be higher or lower value than our existing data points here. And this is similar to what we do in geology. I'll show you how this works. This is similar to a concept in geology when you're trying to work out like the angle of beds and of rock strata, where the rock strata would have been. But so we've got all of our different data points. And what we're going to be looking at is the angle of them from one to another, where they're going. So in this way, we'll go up here, and this one's going to go. It's kind of like the intersecting line here, and the same as the intersecting line from there. Oops. Pretty straightforward. Now, there's different ways of doing spline. You can, so in this version of spline, this is what you call polynomial. You're just trying to get where these angles of these, you know, the vectors between these two is going to create like an intersecting point around about here, and then you're going to get the spline to go through it. Spline always goes through the data points exactly. Well, we'll look at something in a minute where the data points don't go through the points exactly. But in spline, it always does. Now, there's other ways of doing spline. You can actually have one which is where it tries to reduce this curve. So we want to reduce the amount of like outside estimation. So there's another one called cubic spline, where it kind of goes like that. But it still retains that curve. It still tries to smooth it out. all of the different methods for it for now. So effectively, this is our GIS definition of interpolation. So it's using the So we're going to try and fill in the gaps here. We're going to use these interpolation methods to guess the values of these points here. And there's two ways of doing it. We can either use what's called deterministic interpolation, where we're effectively applying an algorithm to each of these points on the map. And the algorithm is always going to be the same. Or there's geostatistical interpolation, when before we actually apply this algorithm, we want to do a separate analysis on top of that, looking at the autocorrelation of these points there. So it's going to create effectively like a meta map, and then we apply our algorithm, that's going to create something new out of it. And the different ones. So first of all, inverse distance weighting. This one's a deterministic method. And the idea is that we're going to go to each single point. So we're creating a raster, and we've only got a limited number of data sources. And around each point in the raster, we're going to draw a radius. And in that radius, there will be a number of data points that are going to be caught in. And we can determine the value of this radius. So in this case, we've got five different data points caught inside there. And it's going to draw a straight line from that data point to where it is, of each of the data points, and it's going to average as the so we're going to assume there's a distance decay of each of these. But as we move away from it, the intensity of that is going to decay downwards, or similar. But the points closer to it are going to proportionally have stronger influence over what this value is going to be. So it's effectively an averaged value of all of these data points once you take into account distance decay. And then it creates something like this. This is what you call a moving average. As you go along, it creates this moving average. But as you'll notice with this one, the line never quite fits inside the data point. So any point on the map which is not a known data point, it's not going to ever quite reach that value. So it's always just going to be just slightly tangential to it. I think that makes a fair amount of sense. And then we've got spline. So again, it's the same idea of this. Spline attempts to smooth out the image as much as physically possible. So there's going to be like no sudden peaks and troughs. It's just the only problem is because we're making it super smooth, it can kind of like kill off some of the details in the actual map that we're creating. So it only really works best if you're dealing with data that has very shallow inclines between them. But as you see, the idea of spline is we're going to always go through the exact data point, and then it's going to create this curve. It's going to run this algorithm, it's going to create a curve between all the data points, and it's going to create this little value. Then it's going to interpolate in some cases, you know, where the data exceeds the data points that we already know. That's a fairly good one. I mean, it's going to, with the previous one, as you saw, it's not going to take a guess on what these values are going to be. It's going to play it nice and safe, just keep inside the existing data values. And then finally, we've got kriging. So kriging is a geostatistical method. It's rather complex from what I remember reading about it. But effectively, kriging does a whole bunch of autocorrelation analysis on top of it. It uses almost identical systems as inverse distance weighting, but then it applies this autocorrelation on top of it. And it's kriging is by far probably going to be the most accurate form of interpolation that you can run. However, it uses up a hell of a lot of computing power because you're just doing so much data there. So if you're worried about ArcMap destroying your computer and making a black hole of data, creeping could be the way to do that. So just be aware. But if you can do it, it's good. But this is an example of like three different ones compared. So these little blue dots here, they're the data points. And as you can see, inverse distance weighting keeps itself nice and safe within the points, the data points. Spline keeps exactly to it, and creaming makes its own way, sometimes inside the data points and sometimes outside of it. Okay. So we'll just have a few quick examples. This one's inverse distance weighting. This is an inverse distance weighting map, and as you can see, it's got fairly good detail in there, but to me, it just looks like all of the slopes between different points, they don't look natural that much. I mean, you can infer a lot from it, but it's kind of just a bit too prescribed. It's a bit too mechanical. There's not a lot of guesswork there, and so the overall outcome of it is not super realistic. And then here's a spline one of the exact same data points. And as you can see, spline just really does smooth off all of the potential like different local curves. So if we have a look in the other one, you see we actually get all these little pock marks around here from the little data points, which are obviously less. But in spline, they're completely gone. And we've still got these like big features here, but spline tends to like just smooth over a lot of values there. And then finally got creaking. And as you can see with creaking, we've put a lot of nuisance on the map. It creates like this terrorist effect, as you can see throughout there. And as I was saying, creaming is probably the best one to do, but it is the one that's going to use up the most computational power. So keep that into mind. As there's like a little phrase in computer science, which is basically like the more it's like you can exchange time or space. And, so the more memory you want to use up, the less time you need, or vice versa. I think that holds true with GIS. The more, if you want a more detailed map, you've got to sacrifice the time it's going to take to build that. Okay. Now, the accuracy of your interpolated map is going to primarily come down to the veracity of your your field data that you've been taking. So here's an example of somebody's gone out into the field, and they're going to take the height and location of all of these points in cross section from one point to another. And they've just decided to do it maybe about once every 20 meters, and that's fine. There, that's going to give us a fairly accurate measuring there. But then looks like they couldn't have been bothered to do that. So when we're going to be drawing a line from there, it's just going to be a straight line. They're going to miss that. Now, as you can see again, we're going to miss a few of these features. So let's draw a spline on top of this, and that's what we get. We get something that doesn't really represent the proper reality of the situation. We're completely missing this huge gully, which is probably the most profound geographical feature in the area. And we're also going to completely miss this gully here, which is again, it's showing us a lot less steep incline than it actually is. So we have to take into account better ways to record our data. So in this one, if we wanted to get a more accurate map, we're going to have to definitively increase the interval between each point on the map. And this is going to give us something much more realistic. So once we do that, and the spline for that, as you can see, it's much closer to reality. Now, of course, the problem of this one, again, just like preview, if you're going out into the field and you're doing this, that is your time or it is your money to pay somebody to go out in the field on your behalf to do this. And this is why data collection is nearly always the most expensive part of any other, you know, any GIS undertaking, because you have to get some poor mug in the field to go around with the total station making readings. But yes. So one of the ways that we can mitigate this is to be smart about the way that we collect our data. And depending on what data you're collecting it for, there's different patterns in ways that we can do this. So for example, if we wanted to be really methodical, we could go for a straight regular grid. At every so many meters, we're going to take ourselves a recording, regardless of what's in between there. Now that may mean, so it means we're going to generally have a pretty good rigorous resolution, but it could mean that if you're wandering along this way and there's a little hill here, we're going to completely miss that. So it could miss off important features doing that, when it's going to be a lot more methodical way of doing it. It's probably going to give us an overall pretty good view of it. And we could just simply do random. So for example, when I was doing my dissertation, I was mapping a little island in Scotland. And you kind of just have to go where you have to go. You have to go where the rocks are. I remember there's just a huge, great, big, bloody ball in one of the fields. And there was a big rock outcrop in the middle of that field, and there was no way in hell I was going to find out what that rock was without getting gored to death by a giant ball. So, unfortunately, I never got to find out if that was a volcanic seal or not. Or we could use what we call transect, where we're going to have straight lines between each of the data points. And that's going to make more sense. If we're trying to map out and collect data of networks, that's the one that's going to make more sense. If we're collecting data about roads in the UK, it makes no sense to go to the middle of the field and go, well, there's no road here, and pop it down on your map. So we've got what we call stratified random. So imagine we've got our grid, but in each point in the grid, we're going to take a specific point in the grid. Now I'd say this one's probably a much better version of like just the regular way to do it, because we can choose the most representative part of each of the areas which we go into. If we wanted to do a cluster, if we wanted to take cluster data points, so imagine again if we're looking at something like, I don't know, population. It makes very little sense to walk into the middle of the field to take a population, you know, do a population census. It makes sense to only really keep it to like urban or suburban environments. And that's why that data would be clustered. Then finally, contours. So that's quite literally, if you're in the OS and you wanted to build a general height map with all of the contours, then that's the best way to do it. That one, of course, pretty time consuming because you've got to work out where those contours are. Okay, so before we move on, I need a drink. Is anybody any questions so far? Are we all good? We're all good. Gosh, I'm steaming along quite nicely as well. Right, so Thessians and Voronoi polygons. Well, they're effectively interchangeable, these two things. We'll see why in just a moment. But effectively, they were the same idea thought up by two different chaps. The first one to do it was a guy called Georgi Voronoi. He was a Russian mathematician. He was very interested in geometry and topology, and he came up with this method. And these are called Voronoi polygons. And then there was a guy who was in the US military, and after he left the US military, he went into meteorology, and he created what he called Thessians. And Thessians just turned out to be the exact same method, but he used it to predict, to estimate rainfall in certain areas. And quite simply, what we're doing, he creates a series of boundaries around a bunch of data points on a map. And these boundaries are going to be the exact midpoint between that and its nearest neighbour. So for example, here, that is the exact intermediate boundary between these two points. Now, it does take into account these
you do get this weird edge effect with Voronoi polygons, as we can't really take into account those other ones around here, but as you can see, it builds these very nice little polygons around these separate points. Now, it does mean that within each of these polygons, the coloured space inside here, the coloured space correlates to the nearest point on the map. So that point there, the nearest point to it is that one there, because it's inside. That's the idea, that it creates an area, and it just describes an area which everything is closest to it, around that data point. And I'll show you how we draw it in just a second. So here's the way that we're going to go. I'll show you a little program on NetLogo in a second, showing you how it works. But so here's all our data points on a map. Doesn't matter what we're recording here. And we triangulate that network. So we run a Delaney triangulation on top of that. And then once we've run that Delaney triangulation, we're going to draw those transects from each of those faces. So the center point of each face in that network, we're going to draw a perpendicular line to it, and where those lines intersect, you'll see it's going to create boundaries of polygons inside there. And we then just fill in the lines there, and creates these, and it gives us a whole bunch of boundaries. So that's the idea of it. It's quite simple. So if I show you something from NetLogo to show you Voronoi polygon construction in action. So, let's say we've got... Okay, so the idea of this, once it's programmed into there, each of those little triangles are individual little agents. They're going to make a boundary. And what they're going to do is they're going to face the nearest, the closest point to them, and then they're going to move away until they're... So they're going to move away from that point until it reaches the time when, if it moved back any further, it would be closer to another point. So it's going to be at every little triangle here is going to be equidistant to another point. So we'll run that. Oh, that's so good. Run that again. But you get the idea of how these Voronoi polygons work. Wonderful little example of that. Right, so let's jump back onto the game. Okay, so what we can do is that, so unlike the other surfaces we've talked about so far, is there's they have fairly high data resolution, but with Voronoi polygons, they can really take advantage of the fact that. So this is what Major Thiessen came up with. He realised that he was trying to use it to predict rainfall patterns, and this is what Voronoi polygons are often used to do. Because the data collection centres are quite far apart, you don't have a very high resolution in what you're trying to do. Yet you're still going to have to try and extrapolate the rainfall patterns in a certain area. So he came up with this sum here. Does everybody know what? Does everybody read the mathematical notation? Yeah, you can read that. No. Okay. So I'll explain it to you. So that, and for everybody at home who obviously doesn't know what it is because they've never turned up to the lecture. So this symbol here is sigma. And this symbol basically means the sum of everything. So we've got to try and describe the sum of everything that we want to count. So let's say the top value of our that we want to sum everything up to is 100. And the bottom value is going to be 1. So that means, so I in this case is just each item in the number between 1 to 100. And then we're going to say I here, so we're going to say, we're going to start off at 1, and at each iteration of this sum, we're going to add
the next value of I, which as we go along will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so you get all the way up to 100. So on here, what this is effectively saying is that, so P is the average rainfall at any one point in this map. And to find this out, what it wants us to do, it wants us to start at 1. So with each of the polygons, we're going to give it a different value. So we're going to start at P1, which is this one here. And we're going to take the rainfall value at the station, and we're also going to times that by the area of that polygon. And then that's the value that we're going to sum together. So for each of those polygons, we're going to take the rainfall value, and we're also going to take the surface area of that polygon. We're going to time those together, and we're going to add each of these together in turn till we reach the maximum number. So in this case, we're saying n is the total number there, and n, of course, is however many of that item there is. And then once we've done that, we just do the exact same, but just with the area. And then we divide this by that, and that is going to give us the average rainfall on any map. Now, we can use that for any other things where we've got fairly low resolution of data points. So, could be population, could be number of deaths from various hazards. But this is one of the best ways to do it. And I'm just going to show you in 1 second, that's in the last slide there, but it's a show you of a really fantastic use of this. Some of you, I guess you guys may remember this one. You're not here for the first lecture, were you?
No.
Okay. You remember this map? Yeah. So this is John Snow's map, who did know a lot. Got it. You're the first person who got the joke. But, so this is John Snow's map. So very famously, so back in 1858, London was hit by this horrific cholera outbreak. And the assumption at the time was that cholera was caused by like the smell, the miasma. There was so much filth in the Thames that this like evil cloud of bad smell was going out and was infecting people. But John Snow was a local physician, and he thought this was a load of hogwash. So he went around every single house in the area was hit by this horrible cholera outbreak. So this is in Soho area. And he recorded how many people in each house was infected by cholera. And he noticed this pattern. They were focused around, these are all water pumps. Each of these blue points, they're a water pump. And he noticed that they're all focused around one particular water pump. But he needed to prove this. And to do that, he created 4-0 polygons. And he drew them around each of the water pumps. And as you can see, there was a very, very clear water correlation there of a bunch of dying people and this water pump there. And subsequently he got it closed down. So that's the method that he used to save a whole bunch of people's lives. I think that's a wonderful example of using data analysis, geographical data analysis, to really show you something and make a difference. And remember, he didn't even have a computer back then, so good on you. Right. Now I think that's pretty much that. My goodness, I stormed through that today. I did that for you, Sam. Space Marine was for you. Right, any questions? No?